the grand aspects of the sport. The end of the era. Should we rate the era now? Like, how good has the Fox era been for the UFC?
Fox era has been excellent for the UFC. So since then, like, the sport has grown a whole lot. I mean, a $4 billion purchase, mm-hmm. 4.2. Actually, I think the final evaluation was closer to 5 after the Fertitta brothers' share was bought out. That minority stake that they yes. retained was bought out. So you're looking at close to $5 billion that the company sold for. You see now they're moving up to ESPN, which is the pinnacle of sports programming. Mm-hmm. They've kind of pushing the idea of streaming television as well. So there are a lot of good things that are going on for the UFC. There are some things as far as the way WME is running the organization that I take issue with. But as far as a broadcasting mm-hmm. entity, they've definitely moved up.
I agree with that. I think obviously ESPN, just compared to Fox Sports, is leaps and bounds a better format, better platform, obviously. I think the Fox era is going to be one that we debate for a long period of time because obviously have been great benefits to it. I said this on, I think, yesterday's show. I don't know if you listened to it, but in the era of like the beginning of the Fox era, we had the rise of not only Ronda Rousey, Conor McGregor, but revolutionary fighters like Dominic Cruz, Cain Velasquez, John Jones. Like, all that simultaneously happened in the era of the UFC joining one of the big four networks, right? Being in, you know, 100 million plus homes. That timing was perfect for MMA. There was a legit explosion with just the casual awareness for MMA. Maybe the average viewerships or buy rates of pay-per-views have gone down, but overall, I think more people know about MMA than ever before, right? Because right. of the Fox era. It's the same era that we've had, again, lowest pay-per-views in almost 20 years. On top of that, the best pay-per-view of all time in UFC history with 2.4 million buys with, obviously, Conor McGregor versus Khabib that happened a few months ago. And again, I think for maybe not us, because I don't think we were necessarily the best historians of MMA, but 20 years down the line, this era is going to be weird. It's going to be one that definitely has its flaws, its negatives, but a lot of positives. I don't know which one's going to weigh out for the legacy of it.
Yeah, I mean, I think the sport itself is in a great transition period. And we can't really tell what it's going to look like. We're way too close to the action. I think this is an era that we're going to look back on 10, 15 years from now and then be able to generate some legit context over what it is. Mm-hmm. There are just way too many things that are going on, too many plates spinning right now for us to really have a definitive idea of what the end of the Fox era actually means.
Yes.
But look at it this way. So when they came to Fox, they were originally on Spike TV, and that was a broadcast partner, and that was the perfect marriage at the time.
Yes.
Spike TV needed some sort of steady programming beyond reruns of Cops that was going to bring in that mm-hmm. demographic that they were seeking.
I mean, the Tough Boom. I mean, I know exactly. It doesn't get talked about as much anymore for some reason, but the Tough Boom was really the first boom era of MMA history in the U.S., and that led the way for a Fox deal, for an ESPN deal, etc.
Right, because I think the Fox deal represents the first time that the UFC didn't have to rely on sort of fringe entities to boost its platform.
Yes.
Because before Spike, there was that partnership that they had. They had some sort of a loose partnership with Fox. It was like you know, some obscure Fox.
Yeah, they had the one Fox show where
the best damn sports show.
Yes, where Tito Ortiz and Chuck Liddell went on, right. And they had their spathing in their second fight.
I think they had Chuck Liddell fight Vitor Belfort on that show as well. It was like 67.5. I believe it was, and you know, and it was some strange things they had to find. You know, they were on the back of a program hosted by Tom Arnold. Like, that was the definition of fringe programming.
And Tom Arnold, best known now for getting in a fight with, what's his name? That's a Trump supporter, right? Remember that happened?
Oh, yeah.
Like, a few months ago? That's Tom Arnold, right? The weird intersection of MMA
and
real life.
He was most known for Roseanne Barr divorcing him. Like, that was his claim to fame, is that he was married to Roseanne Barr at one point in time. You know, yeah, and he was Schwarzenegger's sidekick in True Lies. So I'll give him that. That was my favorite Tom Arnold thing. But before we turn this into a Tom Arnold podcast.
Because, I mean, yeah. That's what it should be,
I mean,
right?
Hey, Tom Arnold deserves
the legend. The legend that is Tom Arnold.
the incredible Tom Arnold. But like, you know, so they went from, you know, going off the back of a Tom Arnold helm show to then going to Spike TV, which at the time was literally just running reruns of Cops all the mm-hmm. time. and weird programming like A Thousand Ways to Die,
Mansers
and Blue Mountain State, and just really. I enjoyed the show.
Blue Mountain State was good, though.
Blue Mountain State was dope.
Yeah, that was actually a decent show.
A Thousand Ways to Die was my jam, though. I used to mess with that a lot.
There was some wild episodes towards the end. But quickly, just to move away from this before we have to head to the Sergio Pettis-Rob Font fight.